Simon & Schuster Audio presents Mean Margaret by Tor Seidler. Read by Simon Jones. With an introduction by the author.
Hi, I'm Tor Seidler. Mean Margaret started out as an exercise in frustration. When I came up with the idea, I had published 5 novels for young readers and 1 for adults, so I thought it would be fun to do something really short, a text for a picture book. The idea was of a fastidious creature whose life is utterly destroyed by a horrible human child named Margaret. I decided the creature should be a woodchuck, partly because when I was about 12, some older cousins of mine goaded me into taking a shot at one with a shotgun, and I actually hit it. I was very guilty about it. I've never touched a gun since, and making my hero a woodchuck seemed a small way of paying for my crime. I called him Fred, after a very fastidious friend of mine. When I showed the story to my editor, he wasn't impressed, but his assistant saw something in it, and she encouraged me to keep trying. I wrote the thing over and over, torturously. I must have done 15 versions. One of them was lying on the corner of her desk when somebody visiting her office noticed it and asked if it was the outline for my next novel. She immediately called to share this tidbit, and I realized it was true. It was an outline for a novel. In short order, it grew from 1,500 words to 150 pages. And it wasn't torture at all. I really enjoyed inhabiting a little girl who turns everything she touches to chaos. In a way, all babies do that, I suppose. But I tried to push the idea to an extreme. There was a line in the New York Times book review I liked. Seidler gives free rein to his sly sense of humor. I don't know how sly my sense of humor is, but I definitely gave free rein to it. I really hope you enjoy the book.
For Holly McGee. A Cold Shoulder. One spring afternoon, Fred was out foraging for food in the meadow when an inky cloud seeped over the sun. He was a good ways from his burrow, nearly to the pig farm, judging by the whiff of the sloppy beasts he'd just caught. Since there was nothing he hated more than getting his fur wet, Fred scampered up into a hole in a maple by the roadside. This required little effort. Woodchucks are distant relatives of squirrels, but the hole was a dreadful mess. "Woodpeckers," Fred muttered. When he poked his head out to look for something better, he was momentarily blinded by a flash of lightning. Then he was nearly deafened by a clap of thunder, and right after that a violent cracking sound set his very bones vibrating. Seconds later the skies opened. "Of all the rotten luck," Fred said. Stuck, Fred passed the time complaining about the filthy habits of woodpeckers. Don't they know what a broom is? Being a woodchuck who lived alone, he often talked to himself. But he turned silent when a pair of fat, ugly human beings came running in under the tree.
"Goodness," said the woman.
"We're soaked to the skin," said the man, who had a big ham under his arm.
Fred held his nose. The odour of the human being's wet clothing wasn't much better than the whiff of pig he'd gotten earlier.
"You know, Mr. Hubble," the woman said after a while, "this really isn't so bad, is it?"
"Nice break from the kids," the man agreed.
Eventually the rain stopped and the sun returned, scattering the meadow with diamonds of light. But to the woodchuck's dismay, the fat, smelly people stayed put.
"Look, Mrs. Hubble," the man said. "A rainbow."
"Where?"
"There, right over the pigsty."
"Oh my, yes. How beautiful."
Fred noticed the rainbow too. However, it was small comfort to him. For now, Mr. Hubble put his free arm around Mrs. Hubble's middle, and Mrs. Hubble leaned her head on Mr. Hubble's shoulder.
"Good grief," Fred said under his breath. "I'm going to be here forever."
But rainbows rarely last very long, and when this one faded away, Mrs. Hubble let out a sigh and said,
"I suppose we better head back. They'll be turning the place upside down."
As soon as the Hubbles waddled off down the road, Fred evacuated the nasty hole. He'd never been happier to get home, though even so, he didn't forget to wipe his feet thoroughly just inside the entrance mound. He took great pride in his burrow. It was the tidiest, most private place imaginable. Digging it had been the low point of his life. Nothing soiled your paws like digging. But at least he would never have to go through that horror again. He'd gritted his teeth and dug extra deep, ensuring that he would never be subjected to the creeping of centipedes or the squawking of blue jays. The only time he was ever disturbed was when a certain striped snake chased some prey down his bolt hole. And this was only a minor annoyance, since the snake was a creature of few words, even when his mouth wasn't full of frog or mouse. Climbing the maple had mussed up Fred's fur, so the first thing he did was carefully clean and brush himself. Then he sat down in his favourite armchair, the one by his jar of glowworms, and recovered from his ordeal, basking in the neatness, the dryness, the luxurious peace of his home. Instead of the glare of lightning, there was the soft glow of the worms. Instead of smelly human beings, there was the pleasant fragrance of his pine furniture. And instead of bone-vibrating cracks, there was sublime silence. He didn't hear a single sound till his own stomach began to growl. Fred padded into his kitchen and fixed himself a special treat. 3 snails on a bed of clover. After dinner, he began to feel pleasantly drowsy, and once he'd cleaned up the kitchen, he covered the glowworms with a leaf, crept into his bedroom, and snuggled into bed. He said his prayers, thanking heaven for giving him everything a woodchuck could possibly want, and closed his eyes. The bed was nice and warm, so when a shiver went through him, he sat up in surprise. "Could I have caught cold in that miserable tree?" he asked himself. "It was damp." He swallowed. "My throat's not sore, though." Fred checked himself for swollen glands. None. The only thing out of the ordinary was a slight chill in his shoulder. He lay back down, burying his chilly shoulder under the covers. Suddenly, he was a married woodchuck, with a wife who warmed his shoulder by leaning her head on it. Fred woke up in alarm. "Phew!" he said, realizing he was alone. "What a terrible dream!" In the morning, the dream seemed the height of silliness. "A wife? What a ridiculous idea," he said as he did his sweeping. "How could you keep things just so with another woodchuck around?" But come evening, the chill crept into his shoulder again, and that night the same dream woke him in the small hours. It became a nightly ritual, a nightly torture for a woodchuck who hated having his routine disturbed as much as Fred did. He tried everything he could think of, sleeping on his back, cutting out strong foods like mint and dandelion greens, counting field mice. But nothing helped. Time and again he sat bolt upright in his bed in the middle of the night, shuddering from the dream of being married. Greenhouse Blues. Woodchucks will nibble nearly any plant, but most of them are partial to vegetables, and at this time of year, it was April, the only place in Fred's neighbourhood where vegetables were readily available was the greenhouse across the meadow. Early in the morning, before the arrival of the gardener, this greenhouse was a very popular woodchuck gathering place. But Fred never went near it. He liked to sleep till 9, and besides, he hated exposing his fur to morning dew. Furthermore, he wasn't crazy about mixing with others. Still, the greenhouse was the obvious spot for wife hunting, and after being plagued by his dream every night for over a week, Fred was desperate enough to try anything. He didn't really want a mate, of course, but if he went through the motions of looking for one, maybe the nightmare would leave him alone and life would return to normal. When the dream woke him for the 10th time, he dragged himself out of his cozy bed and up to his entrance mound. "You've lost your mind, Fred," he said bluntly, staring into the chilly darkness. All he could make out was the white bark of a nearby birch tree. But he forced himself on. devising a greenhouse strategy as he felt his way along. If he spotted a potential wife there, he would go up to her and say, "Excuse me for disturbing you, but I was wondering if you could direct me to the beans." By the time Fred was halfway across the meadow, he was dew-drenched. But the sun was poking up over the horizon, and once he reached the greenhouse, he went over to the east side and positioned himself on a rock so that the sun's rays hit his right side directly and bounced off the greenhouse glass to toast his left. When he was reasonably dry, he gave his fur a quick once-over and followed the scent of his fellow woodchucks behind a shrub and through a missing glass pane. Though comfortably warm, the greenhouse was a bit humid for Fred's taste. But as he made his way around some rather noxious-smelling marigolds, he spotted an attractive female woodchuck over by a row of peas. "Excuse me for disturbing you," he said, going up to her, "but I was wondering if you could direct me to the beans." The female looked surprised.
"Why?"
"Well, I thought I might sample one."
"But the beans are so stringy. Try one of these."
She held out a pawful of peas. No thanks. It was too early for breakfast, and besides, he liked to wash his food before eating it.
"Oh, go on,"
she said, popping a couple of peas into her mouth.
"They're yummy."
She smiled as she chewed, to show how delicious they were. But all Fred saw were her pea-green teeth. She chewed with her mouth open. He was so disgusted, he slipped out of the greenhouse and went straight home. But that night, the chill snuck back into his shoulder, and the same dream disturbed his slumber. So he went through the whole ordeal again, dragging himself out of bed and across the sodden meadow, drying himself on the rock, slipping into the muggy greenhouse. This time he made his way over to the carrots. Carrots were said to be brain food. Maybe there he would find a woodchuck intelligent enough to chew with her mouth closed. And indeed he saw a very appealing female.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.